Download the Keynote demo file you see in the wiki, and decompress it to see the contents. You'll see a range of multimedia assets including sound files like MP3 and WAV, movie files in MP4 format, JPG and PNG image files, a document file filled with URLs locating the source for these files, and finally a Keynote file with the extension .ky. Click on this file to open it in Keynote. In the slide browser column to the left, you'll see four slides, one of which you'll see in the main content area. You'll also see the top toolbar and the right sidebar that contains format, animate, or document palette. This demonstration assumes you have taken the Keynote tutorials specified in New Media Wiki. If you haven't, they are located in the links available in Wiki. Do these before you continue with this demo. Okay, so we're quickly going to highlight how the main elements of this show were created. We won't be discussing things like new slide creation, master slides, changing themes, text insertion, image insertion, and other basics handled in the Keynote tutorials. Instead, we're highlighting the workflow and most useful tools used to generate the final movie. Slide 1 contains the title of the work and the author's name. It's a good idea to have an identity for the work as well as an author, and this doesn't have to be the very first thing you see. It can be at the end, which we'll see an example of, or even somewhere moments into the work, but it's a rookie mistake to miss at least putting your authorial stamp on your own work. Text in Keynote is handled in a similar manner to other programs you've used for formatting text. We won't go so deep into this other than to remind you that text styling is handled under the format palette. Slide 2 contains a few assets including a video file that runs as a moving background image, a PNG file of a head that looks strangely placed off the slide, and a PNG file clip art of eyes. There is also a drawing here that looks like a glowing laser beam, and if you look carefully something that's off-screen that looks like a little speaker. This signifies a sound effect, and we'll talk more about it when we get into using sound later. Slide 3 contains a giant version of the head we saw off the viewable area in the previous slide. It's inside a circular mask that is much larger than the viewable area. The final slide contains URLs for all the assets used in this work, a PNG file with the Creative Commons logo to signify our license, and the title and author text once again. This slide kind of functions like closing credits in a movie. The movie has a soundtrack, which doesn't show up on any slide. If you have a soundtrack that you need to play over all the slides for the duration of the show, you place that in the document palette under the audio tab. When you add an audio file to the soundtrack content area, Keynote sort of wishes you'd use iTunes, but it is much easier to simply drag and drop the sound from your asset folder right into this content area. Once it's in place, you can set the volume, and you can also set the soundtrack to play once or to loop. Here, we play it once. Now, here is where things get wacky in Keynote. You need to pre-edit your soundtrack to precisely the length you want, or else all the automated and animated settings you create to run the show like a video will be overridden by what is usually an overly long soundtrack. Keynote does not have a great way to handle this, so before we actually place the sound file in Keynote, we open it in QuickTime. Mac will want to force it to open in iTunes, so you have to right-click and select QuickTime from the contextual drop-out menu. This file is a long MP3 we downloaded from Free Music Archive under a Creative Commons license. We need to trim it to about a minute. To do this, we copy the file first, then in the copy drag the time bar window as wide as our screen, then under menu find edit and select trim. The yellow frame with the light gray wavy bar is a waveform, a graphic expression of the sound. To trim, simply drag the ends of the yellow frame to the desired points and hit the trim button. You may need to try this a few times to get the trim right, which is why you want to work on a copy of the original. When the trim is right, you can hit save and it will create a new file for you. But horrors, it's now a MOV file. This will not play in Keynote. So you can open the MOV in QuickTime, and in the menu, select export and audio only. Great, this saves as an M4A audio file which you can load into Keynote. Since we're talking about pre-editing media assets, let's take a look at the movie file in the background of the second slide. If you select the asset, you'll see a play button appear in the center, and this will show you the video. In the right sidebar format palette under the movie tab, notice the volume for the soundtrack is turned all the way down. I don't want the original voiceover in my movie, so this turns it off. Look under Edit Movie, and you'll see the first 5 seconds or so has been trimmed, and I've selected from about 5 to about 19 seconds as the amount of this total video that I need. Finally, you have a choice to repeat, which we don't do here, and importantly, we uncheck Start Movie on click. Speaking of unclick, we want to make sure that everything in our show is automated or timed, and that nothing depends on a mouse click. So you'll see different ways to create automatic motion in this show. Let's digress a bit and head over to the left sidebar thumbnail views. Notice each slide has a blue rectangle. Recall from tutorial this indicates a transition has been applied to the slide. In this work, the transition dissolve was applied uniformly to all the slides. Click on any one of the slide thumbnails and then select the animate palette to display at right. You'll see the parameters for dissolve as a 2-second duration, with a 2-second delay. The transition is set to start automatically, not on click. If transitions handle animation between one slide and another, what handles animation of objects within a slide? There are two classes of operations that handle objects in a slide. Actions and builds, with a subgroup of build in and build out for the builds. Actions create effects like movement, opacity change, rotation, and scaling, and some funky things like jiggling or flipping. Builds are basically like transitions, but applied to an object, not a slide. Take some time to analyze the build order for the objects on each slide. We do this by clicking on the build order button at the very bottom of the animate palette. This is an easy thing to forget, but for this project, the build order window may be the single most important thing to use. Notice in the first slide there are four builds: a build and dissolve for the first text, a build and dissolve for the second text, a build out dissolve for the first, and another for the second. Each build has a relationship to a previous event. For example, the first dissolve happens after transition, with a delay of 2 seconds. The dissolve itself is a 2-second event as seen in the palette, so the total duration of this event is 4 seconds. You can analyze each of the objects in each of the slides to see exactly how actions, build-ins, and build-outs develop into the full 60-second long show. It's important to keep track of the timings and delays associated with each event. An excellent use of your sketchbook is to develop a timeline and make notes about durations to avoid going too fast or too slow. A couple of special events to note are the use of sound effects and drawing elements, both of which are on slide 2. If you zoom this window way out, you'll see the sound effect icon next to the head. This was created by simply dragging the file named raw.wav into the window. It doesn't matter where this icon lands, because it's invisible in the final work. But I'm a visual person, so I just keep it outside of the visual field. The sound effect is associated with the drawing that looks like little laser beams. It's called group in the build order window. The build and wipe is associated with this drawing, and because we want the crazy sound to happen with the wipe, notice how this is arranged to occur with that build-in at step 5. One small liability here is that if you hit preview in the build order window, it doesn't really play the sound for you to hear, so the only way to test this is to hit the main play button. When we do, it's useful to hear how the sound effect interacts with the soundtrack. So get into the sample file and dig around analytically to see how it works. As a little library of events, it covers many of the things you'll do. Of course, you may or may not use all the techniques you see in the file, but if you are going to perform some kind of operation, you'll probably see it in action here.